very much. It's great to be here all the way from the UK. It's nice to be invited, so thank you Oriel, Shulman and Nicole for inviting me. I've been working on social media and SciComm over in the UK, and more globally vended in Twitter for the last 5 years. And I'm not a researcher, but I've sort of been taking this into the research community by looking at the altmetrics of social media and how social media contributes to the altmetrics score of articles. And we've also started looking at the impact that that's now having on citations. three or four people might retweet it. And then that's it, they don't do anything else. But your research is global. It might be local to you, but it's global. Twitter, Facebook, it's all global. So put out five or six tweets, reword it, add different graphics, make it visible, make it different each time, and put it out at different times. You know, you might have collaborators in Australia that are working on a similar project, so time it for them to pick up in the morning when they get to work. And the other thing that you can do is you can focus on the social sources that score points that you yourself can actually make a difference. So don't look at news media. You know, news media is fine, it scores most points. It would be great if everybody managed to get an article on Fizz or on Science Daily every week. Happy days. But you have no control over getting into that media stream. So concentrate on the social sources of social media that you can work on, you can have direct control of, direct influence over. Some social media aren't included. So Instagram, which is becoming popular. Instagram is actually the largest growing medium for science communication at present because it's so popular. It doesn't score for our metric because they don't have hot links to papers. And the Chinese site Weibo, no longer does it used to, but no longer. So, this year, myself and a couple of colleagues looked at the main scoring streams, the 10 ornithology journals. So we looked at over 2,500 research articles published over a 4-year period. What we were trying to see is that where in ornithology do we actually score more than most of our contribution to our metric score? The answer is Twitter. So if you're not on Twitter, get on it, because that's where most of the contribution comes from. So if you look at the news media, although it scores 8 points per mention, it only actually contributes 13% of the overall score towards ornithology altmetrics score over a 4-year period. So Twitter is nearly 3/4. So that is a dynamic platform. I would imagine that pretty much everybody in the room is on it. But it is where ornithology is talked about on social media. To a lesser extent, it's on Facebook. Facebook tends to be more fragmented. It tends to be on pages rather than be in open fora. And blogs are more static, so they're obviously web-based, but you can drive people to a blog using the social media. So I'm always surprised at how many people have never actually looked at the altmetric information behind their research article. So virtually every paper now, regardless of your publisher, there will be an altmetric score somewhere on your abstract or your opening page of your paper. So this is for wider journals, which IBIS is part of. I've circled the altmetric ticker counter. And if you clicked on that, this is what you would see. Down on the left there, it gives you a quick summary of where you're actually scoring your altmetric contributions from. And then up at the top, there's actually some tabs, which allow you to drill down and see the actual breakdown. And it will give you, on the Twitter tab, you can look at all the people who've actually retweeted and tweeted about your paper. So you might find new collaborators there, people that you never knew of that are actually working in your field. I did a little analysis of this paper. This is our top scoring paper from IBIS. And I wanted to see whether or not the altmetric contribution for each of these platforms matched the overall contribution that I showed you earlier. And it's pretty much the same, very, very close. So with this paper, a lot of the Twitter score was contributed by the author themselves down in South Africa and by BOU, My Society. So we contributed 36% of the overall Twitter score to this one individual paper. So you'll see that we've got 420 tweets from 281 users. So it means that a number of those 281 users were actually tweeting about it multiple times. And I know Arjun, the author, tweeted about it, I think it was 32 times. BOU is the Publishing Society, we tweeted about it, I think it was 42 times. So that's where you get the disparity from. But individual authors can also drive their own papers. So this is a paper that came out earlier this year in Bird Conservation and BirdLife Journal. And one author who was new to Twitter, she'd only been on it a little while, didn't like it, went away. And then when this paper was published, she emailed me and she said, should I tweet about it? Can you publishing society and as a ornithology society, the BLU actually contributes to the outmetrics of all journals. So we don't just tweet about our own content, we tweet about all content from any journal. So this is another paper from earlier this year from Bird Study, the BTO journal. And as you can see, the BLU contributed 85% of the Twitter contribution, the blog, and the Facebook. And that's in line with, in 2015, we did some analysis and we found that the BLU contributed anything up to 95% of the individual journals' outmetrics. Societies and institutes also do this. So in 2013, the RSPB looked at their own research and what the outmetric scores of their research were, and it wasn't very good. So over a two-year period, using just Twitter and blogs, they managed to increase it fourfold. So institutes can drive this for themselves. They can do it as an institute, so they can also get their own institute research to actually promote their own papers. If you want to look at the next stage around the links to citations, I've got a poster this evening, and we've done some analysis based on exactly the same 2,500 papers that we've looked at and talked about already. And we talk about the drive that Outmetric is now having and the impact it's having on citation and whether or not we predict citability of papers in ornithology. So just to summarise social media on ornithology, if you're not on Twitter, get on Twitter, use hashtags, follow lots of people. There's lots of self-help stuff out on the internet. There's loads of stuff on the BLU website on using Twitter in particular. Go out and read it. Be seen. Don't just sit there and not be seen. Be seen. Tweet regularly. Tweet often. Retweet other people's stuff. Blog. Another thing you can do yourself. Set up your own blog. Blog with people at the BLU. There's lots of blogs out there. Just make sure that the blog that you're blogging with is registered with Outmetric in order for you to get the score from your blog. A couple of recommended reading. A couple of books here, Social Media for Academics, and another recent one. All these slides are on Twitter, they're all on Periscope, they're all on Fixshare, so you don't have to make a note of these now, you can do later. We've got a Twitter conference coming up later this year. We've just opened submissions, so if you want to present your research, you'd like to go to the BLU website and have a look. If you need to know, well, thank you to all my collaborators and of course to the three organisers, Oriel, Jordan, Nicole, for inviting me today. And if you need to find anything about the BLU further on social media and ornithology, just come to our website, Twitter, Facebook.
The goals and motives of someone that's actually trying to reach out to you. I want living, commercial anglers, aquaculture. My nephew who likes to swim in the lake, and those kinds of folks all need to know a little bit about what I'm working on. And but that can be challenging. When we're trained as scientists, we tend to talk like we do to our peers in a very technical way. However, we need to think about other ways of talking with people, of communicating back and forth with these different resource users if we want to advance conservation and resource protection. And social media gives us a really great set of tools for doing that. It makes us think very carefully about what information we want to share with others. And so, again, as scientists, we tend to be the people on the right-hand side here, right? Think about how you write a journal article, or if you've read a lot of journal articles. We start with a ton of background and what everyone else before us has done. And then we give some more details about our study sites. And when are we going to get to the point, right? We don't get to the conclusion until we're at the end of the paper, right? That's when we give our results in our discussion. Well, the public doesn't want to read like that. They don't want to get their information like that. The first thing they want to hear is, what's the bottom line? awareness of our organization. So we have very specific goals that we wanted to achieve. And then we moved on to creating some measurable objectives, things that we could actually go back and look and see if we're reaching them or not. And I don't list them all here, but we got an idea of how often do we want to be present on Facebook, on Twitter. And we set the bar low. We're just starting out. We wanted to see where it would go. We wanted to see increasing followers and a number of other things. So having goals, measurable objectives, helps you know whether you're going where you want to go with your science communication. Number three, who is your audience? You need to know who your audience is. Who are you trying to communicate with? In this case, you know, who are they? What do they know? What are they excited about? And also, how do they see you? As an organization or as an individual, how do they see you? Are you an intimidating scientist that they might not understand? Are you personable and approachable and a real human being just like them? How do they see you and how do you want to present that? I'll give another example from my own experience. As I said, I work primarily in the water world and do a lot of work with invasive species. And one audience that I work with a lot is boaters. Boats on trailers transfer invasive species between lakes and rivers more than any other vector. We've long said that, you know, birds aren't the problem. The problem is us with our trailers and our boats. And so we work with boaters to have them clean their boats. We offer boat washing. We do social media about this. We share information. We've created videos and so forth. But I recently started another program, this Ripple program, that's aimed at people who keep aquariums. People don't want their aquarium anymore, they dump it in the nearest lake, let Nemo go, that's a problem. We don't want those fish and other organisms, plants, potential viruses, snails, things like that released. So I had to learn about that audience, because I'm not a big aquarist, I don't know that audience well, and so it helped to learn what they would be concerned about. While boaters are concerned about having good access to their lake and not having it choked out with weeds, people who keep aquariums are concerned about humane disposal. This was my pet. This was an animal that I cared about. How do I, if I can't care for it anymore, what are some options for me other than letting it go? And so those are ideas that we talked about. We also created, so one of the things that we did was create Facebook for the program. Teachers was another audience for this program. We wanted to make sure that teachers knew that at the end of the school year, the best thing to do with your aquarium isn't go release it in a nearby pond. A study in Minnesota found that half of science teachers were doing that and releasing whatever might be in that aquarium into the local water bodies, which is a problem. Number four, choose your tools wisely. Again, we come back to Facebook. There's lots of different platforms. Facebook is the most used platform across the U.S., but that might not be the right platform for what you're doing. We've talked a lot about Twitter, and scientists are very active on Twitter. What's your age group you're thinking about? Who do you want to reach and where are they? And there's places where you can find that information. The Pew Internet study is one great place to go for that information. It shows trends in use of different social media tools. There's also other areas, forums and so forth, that you can get on. Do you want to use video? Do you want to use a lot of photos? Those are questions to ask yourself. Or do you want to just present information, kind of a one-way outreach? Or are you looking to have a conversation, which Twitter is really good for, that back and forth conversation? Telling stories is extremely important and something you should have in your toolkit. These are some advertising posters, old style movie posters that were created by some colleagues of ours in the invasive species world about Asian carp. Nobody wants flying carp in their waterways, but that's something that we're concerned about in this part of the country. And so these you. And then finally, a just general piece of advice is to get out there and explore and practice. There's a growing appreciation for science communication now among the scientists across disciplines. There's good books out there, and this is just a smattering of examples of organizations that are out there doing good work, that have information, workshops, great websites. And then finally, you know, getting online. Again, we're pushing Twitter a little bit here, but just getting in on social media and exploring what other people are doing. What do you like? What do you want to emulate? And especially looking outside your own field can be really valuable. So I'll end it there. Contact information, including Twitter handle, is up there, and I might even have a moment for questions. So thanks.
Thank you. I was gonna say I can add in on that. Like I have my Wildlife Bio account that I do everything, but I also have my SciComm Monday account that I do my broadcasting from. So that's like a separate entity on its own. So like you can have two accounts, but you need to have that, you know, real reason behind that second account. You know, that own entity to do it. That would be my recommendation. So. Yeah, because say for me, a lot of people know me better as Wildlife BioGal. Like even some of my friends, like when they're talking about me with each other, they just say Wildlife BioGal rather than referencing me as Nicole Wood anymore. So by changing your handle, you're losing all of that, you know, commodity that you've built up, that SciComm commodity, and you're just kind of like throwing it into the wind and you're having to start all over again because people associate your handle with who you are. Like whenever I think of Ariel, I think of Rally Day Rule. So it's just you kind of just associate that with that person.
Thank you.
social media, they'll just rush. Just create your account and sit back. Follow the people that you know you respect. Follow some societies that you know and trust. And just get a feel of the tone. That's what you're trying to get. You're trying to establish your tone. And your community will have a tone. The individuals within your community will have a tone. Some of you are passive, some of you are aggressive. So I think if you just sort of sit back and just watch it go by, just get a feel, and then just go in gradually, don't just jump straight in. We have another question.
Do I have time for one more question?
So my question is a little bit like the question that was asked earlier on somebody who's not familiar with social media, and I believe it's probably not something I can do. But I'm at a stage in my career where I'm really interested in scientific communication. And I have a book that's coming out in the fall, but I also want to leverage a whole bunch of things at the same time. I'm creating a series of 90-second national videos that want to come out once a week throughout the year to show people in New England, for example, that there are schools that I see. With the idea of my question to you and anybody else here is, if you have some suggestions about how I might, the institutions behind me, and other ones behind me, so I have some heft. There's like a YouTube channel. Should we be having a Twitter account that's promoting each of the videos that they come out? Any feedback about how it's structured? These things are way, way too much work for me to produce them and not reach other people.
Did everybody hear the question? Yeah, great. The one thing that I'll give you instantly, and you've already started it, that's collaborate. There are people that will within easy reach. They might be in your department, they might be in the society. You said you've already got the old one on board. So if you can't do it yourself, there's too much pressure put on academics to do their own side hop. And you know, that's something I really don't like, because some people don't like to do it, some people don't want to do it, some people shouldn't be allowed to do it. They're not good for themselves or for the institute. So collaborate. Find some people that you know and trust. Use the Audubon Society. They'll know it. You know, and let them lead you to social media. There's no point having a YouTube channel if you've not got social media to be able to.
We're also having a roundtable Friday evening, where we're going to have an hour of more question and answer about these kind of things. Or questions after the session. Circle wants to be more than happy to talk to you about that. But it's time for talks to start again. I'm Arielle Fernier. I'm a postdoc at Mississippi State University. I recently stopped in time now. Okay. I'm Arielle Fernier. I'm a postdoc at Mississippi State University. I recently finished my PhD at the University of Arkansas, where I studied rail migration in the state of Missouri, which led to the absolutely wonderful hashtag MoRails. And I'm going to be talking with all of you today about my experiences sharing my research with other academics and also with the general public live from the field in Missouri. Okay. So a lot of people, you know, I talk about how I tweet my fieldwork, and most people are like, well, what on earth would you even tweet? Most people seem to think, well, the public seems to think that fieldwork is all just like glorious, like jumping through fields and seeing birds and doing all kinds of fun things. And then all the academics are like, fieldwork is really hard and muddy. And why would you want to share that with people? So, you know, I'm trying to find a good balance between those. We want to show the public what fieldwork is and how complex it is and how challenging it is and also how fun it is. So there's kind of a couple things we want to kind of hit right off the bat. You always want to use a lot of photos. Whether they're things like this, which is my collaborator, Rebecca Brasso, at Southeast Missouri State, showing feathers before we run them for mercury, or whether it's a photo of me covered from head to toe in mud because I got my ATV stuck again. All these things. We want to show our methods. We want to show why we are sciencing. We want to show the funny things that happen, like getting another flat tire, which I eventually, in my fieldwork, started to blame on the rail mafia, because we were convinced that the rails were actively going around and puncturing our tires. You know, we want to show the realities of fieldwork, and we also want to show what happens after the fieldwork. I talk to the general public a lot in my work, and a lot of times there's this perception that science is like way too slow, and if you scientists would just like work harder, we could get all this done way faster, because they see us out in the field, and then they hear that we like published a paper like 4 years later, and they're like, well, that just seems lazy.
also a great way to show off your organism. So I study rails in this room. A lot of you have probably seen rails. When I talk to Audubon societies, I meet people who didn't even know that rails exist. And those are birders. If you talk to members of the general public, they think I work for the transportation industry. So Twitter is a really great way to show off your organism. I mean, even if you are a birder, you probably haven't seen Sora very many times or really up close. It's also a really great way to share really cool things that you see in the field. Like this Sora, you may not be able to see this very well in this photo, but it's sitting with just its head above the water. Its body is completely submerged after this bird dove underwater, swam 5 meters, and popped its head back up again. That's not a thing that most people get to see, but I can show that through Twitter while I'm out with you. Twitter is also really a great way to tell a story. Unlike something like Facebook or a blog where you kind of have this longer medium, I can, while I'm out in the field doing things, be able to kind of share a story. So in this case, it's a very short one. For my surveys, we're out doing nocturnal surveys at night, and it's me and my technician both doing surveys at different spots. And we have a policy in my project that when you see a yellow rail, you stop what you're doing and you catch it. Well, my technician did not succeed at catching a yellow rail, sent me the coordinates, and so since I was done with my surveys, I went over to those coordinates, challenge accepted, and caught the rail 20 minutes later. This is a great way of kind of showing just kind of the ups and the downs and the regular daily flow of what field work is like, which people really seem to like and we get a lot of really good feedback. It's also a really good way to show off the habitat. I work in wetlands. Most people have never been to a wetland. Most people have known that I already go to a wetland. I wish more people would go to them, but most people aren't going to. And so I want to show them as being the really complex and important and also really beautiful ecosystems that they are. I mean, these sites that I'm working on in Missouri are gorgeous. They're state and they're federal properties. They are owned and paid for by the people of the United States and by the people of Missouri. And most people have no idea these places exist and that they're great places to go hiking and go birding and just to enjoy being outside. It's also a really fun place to start conversations. This is where a lot of my work with the general public over Twitter starts. It's just by posting observations and having people ask me questions about them. I've done a lot of work with different high school teachers that I've connected with through Twitter that have started with conversations like these. So I have two sites in Missouri, two back-to-back nights. We had over 250 birds at one site and basically no birds at the other site. Why did that happen? The conditions are pretty similar between the two sites. And so over the next 2 hours, the morning after these surveys were done, I had conversations with three different high school classes about what could be some of the reasons. These kids were looking at radar. These kids were looking at weather patterns, trying to figure out what might have made these sites that are pretty close together, especially as the bird flies, why would they have had different densities? I don't know the actual answer to this question, but they were able to look at it the same way I would have looked at it the following morning. And the other one is also just to make observations like things like barred owls eat Sora. I saw on a survey last night. I shared that with people. And it is always interesting to me. So I study rails, and most people seem to think that I refuse to acknowledge that they're part of the food chain. Because people are like, oh, this is so horrible. And I'm like, what are you talking about? This is really cool. Like, I was driving along, and all of a sudden the Sora flushed, and a barred owl grabbed it. Like, harriers eat them too. If you want to see photos later today, I actually have photos of a king rail that was found in the stomach of a bullfrog. Like, these birds get eaten by all different kinds of things, and it's really cool, and it's a good way to show people that, like, yes, I really care about this one group of birds, but we're also really interested in how they're connected to the entire system. It's also just a good way to share excitement. Scientists, we often get a bad rap as being really boring and monotone and quiet, and, like, we don't really care about what we do because we're super serious. I don't accept that. Sharing excitement is really important. So every night that we would go out to catch rails, we would have a goal of catching 20 birds. And if we did, I would post as many Sora photos as I possibly could the next day. And people really enjoyed these. A lot of folks have, like, this one idea in their head. If they know what a Sora is, they think they know what it looks like. And I was able to show these birds have a huge amount of variation in their facial coloring. Some of them have this really beautiful blue-gray. This female here has, like, this really beautiful browns, kind of helping people to appreciate that a bird that they think they might know has a lot of variation, and it's really quite beautiful. It's also a great way to show the realities of field birds. So a lot of people in the public, you know, I tell people that I work in wetlands and that I get to drive around in ATVs, and I'm like, oh, that sounds like a lot of fun. It is. It's also a lot of work. We put ATVs in wetlands. ATVs aren't supposed to be in wetlands. This doesn't end very well sometimes. And so, you know, I get to show the realities of things like ATVs break. There's oil pouring out of the bottom of my ATV all over my trailer, and I have to figure out how to deal with that. initially to allow all of the managers from all my sites in Missouri to attend my defense because I worked in archives at school in Arkansas. But I ended up having over 600 people watch my defense and be able to ask questions live and follow up with me later. I had people on four different continents attend my defense remotely and be able to participate in that process, which was something I was super excited about. Also allowed a lot of my family to attend, which would have been impossible either. So, I mean, there are a lot of different ways of measuring success, a lot of different ways of putting your science out there, and it can be a really, really rewarding process. A few little tips on choosing a hashtag. You generally want to choose something short. So on Twitter, you have 140 characters, and those get eaten up quickly. So you want your hashtag to take up as few as possible. MoRails is a good example of this. It's more difficult for some projects. And you really need to think about all the different ways that your hashtag might be read. So when I created MoRails, it seemed pretty straightforward to me. Mo is Missouri, rails are rails. Well, if you're not in the U.S., you don't know that Mo means Missouri. And so that creates some confusion. And it created confusion for a lot of folks, but it also created some funny moments, like thinking it's like, more rails, which I think is a pretty great kind of interpretation of things. But yeah, lots of different interpretations. It's always good to kind of check acronyms and make sure the acronyms you're using mean in all contexts what you think they mean, so you're not accidentally using acronyms that mean things you don't think. But sure, hashtags are really helpful. And also, Twitter is all about building community, and it's not something that happens overnight, though starting to build community at a conference like this can be really helpful, since you'll have a chance to meet some of those people in person, and can kind of start to get a little bit of a following. It took me kind of 4 years to get, I started on Twitter 4 years ago, and it's grown over that time. And it's been really fun. So I was able, kind of my claim to fame is that my defense hashtag trended on Twitter for a short period of time. That's pretty exciting. We have 450 viewers on YouTube for some of the videos that I posted live from the field. The MoRails hashtag was seen by over 5,000 users. Twitter is also a really great support system. Being a graduate student in the South is not always a simple thing. Being a postdoc in the South is not always a simple thing. Twitter can be a great way to get support, to find collaborators. I have 3 papers from Twitter. I'm working on 3 more. I wouldn't be at the symposium today without Twitter. I also wouldn't have my postdoc without Twitter. There's so much that can be gained from the support system, the archaeologists, the statisticians, the R people, all of the things on Twitter. It can be a really powerful force, just for you personally, be a really, really great way to reach the public and to reach out to really important people like high school teachers, especially high school teachers in rural areas that don't have a university nearby to bring students in. I'm able to Skype into those classrooms, interact with those students on Twitter, talk to them about why science is important, why they should care about wetlands in Missouri, why they should care about the wetlands where they are in Kentucky and Alabama. So it can be a really, really powerful force in that way as well. And with that, I will take any questions. I know that I talk fast, I just can't stop it. But anyway, I just want to point out my all-time favorite hashtag is rails where they don't belong. And so every time I find rails where they don't belong, like interrupting a NASCAR race or on a boat in the middle of the Gulf of Mexico, I tweet it out under this hashtag. It's pretty fun. There's also the yellow rail that was found in Wrigley Field before the Cubs won the World Series. Clearly this was what caused the win. Check that out, and I'm happy to take any questions that anybody has. Really great program. You don't have to be on Twitter to use it. It's just a really very, very cool. Share things not as they're happening, and it can still be very